Hello friends, this is Yogesh Murumkar. In this video, we are going to talk about HBase, Hive and Hadoop. So we are going to do different tasks on Hadoop, HBase and Hive. So this is the problem statement which we are going to talk about in this video. Writing an application using HBase and HiveQL for flight information system, which is going to include first one, creating, dropping and altering database tables. Then creating an external Hive table to connect to HBase for customer information table. Then third one is a loading table with data, inserting new values and fields in the table, and finally joining tables with Hive. Next one is creating index on flight information table, and the last one is finding the average departure delay on a particular day in particular year. So these are the things which we are going to do hands-on. So what we need is we should have Hadoop installed. So let me check whether it is started or not. So with JPS, if I check it, it is not showing me any node, so I will have to start it. So just type the command start dash all dot sh. So currently I am in slash home slash Saurabh directory, and I have typed start dash all dot sh command to start Hadoop. How to start Hadoop, how to stop it, we have already talked about it in our previous videos, and we are already familiar with Hadoop. Hadoop is nothing but the framework which is written in Java. So what we need for doing all those tasks which we have seen earlier at the start of the video, we need all those three things, that is HBase, Hive and Hadoop, already installed on our machine. So in my case, I am working on my virtual machine on which I have already installed and configured Hadoop, HBase and Hive. So in my case, all three are integrated. So how to install Hadoop, HBase and Hive? If you want information about that, so I have already prepared the videos separately for each one of them, and you can refer those. But to understand whatever you are going to do here in this video, you should be ready with all those three things, Hadoop, HBase and Hive. So Hadoop is a framework which is written in Java, and it can be used for big data. So after typing start dash all dot sh, you can see it is starting different nodes. So it is starting data node, then it is starting name node and secondary name node, and finally it is starting resource manager and node managers. So start dash all dot sh is the command. I am able to start Hadoop because it is already configured on my machine. So it has started already, it has already started all the nodes. So let it get finished. So don't worry about the warnings if it is showing warning. So if I type JPS, now it should show me all the nodes, name node, data node, node manager, resource manager and secondary name nodes. If I see all five nodes, then only I can say that Hadoop is properly running on the machine. So yeah, it is showing all the five nodes. You can check it here. So Hadoop is already running. Now what I will do is I will start with Hive. So in my case, Hive is installed in this downloads folder. That's why I typed cd space downloads. So this is the folder for Hive. I will go inside that folder because I will have to go to bin folder inside Hive. So the version of the Apache which we are using is 2.3.2. So cd space that Apache folder, and here you can see bin folder. So I will go inside bin folder, and to start Hive, I will need a file. This one, that is Hive. It's actually a script using which I can start Hive in my case. So dot slash Hive, if I type, it is going to start Hive. So it might take some time because I have already I am already running it on a virtual machine. So not much time, but it might take some time in your case depending on the memory. So it is starting Hive. We already know Apache Hive is a data warehouse software project built on top of Apache Hadoop for providing data query and analysis. So you can see here, once I type dot slash Hive, it is starting it, right? And Hive gives a SQL like interface to query data stored in various databases and file systems that integrate with Hadoop. So we already talked about it. Hive uses a query language called as HiveQL, which is similar to SQL. So whenever you want to talk with Hadoop by using SQL like queries, you can go for Hive. So in my case, as it is already configured, that's why I'm able to run Hive like this. So remember, in my case, I have installed Hive in download folder. So yeah, you can see the Hive shell here. Right now I am on Hive shell, so I can type the queries. For example, if I type this one, show databases, so it should show me all the databases which are already created in my case by using Hive. So let's wait. It should show me the list of the databases with this show databases command. So you can check, this query is exactly similar to the SQL query which you can use in case of MySQL or Oracle database. So show database and semicolon. So it is saying okay. That means the query is read and these are the list of databases which are already created in my case. Now the next command is, what we will do is we will create a database. So the to create a database, the command is create database and database name. So let me create a database with the name MyDB300. So see, you can check, it is saying okay. That means it has run. And if I type show database once again, you can see the database which we have created, that is MyDB300. Now to use that database, the command is use and database name. So I will type it like this, use space MyDB300. So it is saying okay. That means now, right now I am using that database. Now what we will do is, once we have started Hadoop and Hive, now we will start Edgebase. So to start Edgebase, in my case it is installed in downloads folder only. So I will have to go to downloads folder. Currently this is the location, /home/Saurav. I will go to downloads folder, and in downloads you can check, for Edgebase this is the folder, right? This one is for Edgebase, and you can check the version also. So I will go inside that folder. It is 1.2.6 version. Once I go into Edgebase, you can see bin folder is there. So I will go into bin folder of the Edgebase, and if I type ls, you can check there are different scripts which are there. For we are going to use this one, start-edgebase.sh. So let me clear it. I will type the command to start Edgebase here. So it is /start-edgebase.sh. Once I type it, it should start Edgebase. So I have already told you, Hive, Edgebase and Hadoop, all these three things are already configured in my case, and that's why I'm able to run this command. How to do that, how to configure Edgebase and Hive and Hadoop, we already prepared the video and we have seen those things in previous videos. So it has start, it is starting Edgebase. Apache Edgebase is an open source non-relational distributed database modeled after Google's Bigtable, and it is also written in Java. It is developed as part of Apache Software Foundation's Apache Hadoop project, and it runs on top of HDFS or Elixir, providing Bigtable like capabilities for Hadoop. You can check, it is started. Now to go to shell, I have typed /edgebase/shell. It should take me to the Edgebase shell, where I will be able to type the queries related to Edgebase database. So it's a non-relational database, or we can say it's a column oriented database or columnar database. That means it processes the data in the column oriented fashion, not like MySQL or Oracle, which processes the data in row oriented fashion. So remember, to start Hive there is only one command, that is /hive, but to start Edgebase we have used two commands. What we have done is, first of all, we have use a script called as start-edgebase.sh, that is /start-edgebase.sh in case of Edgebase. And then once it has started all the processes related to Edgebase, now you can check, I have typed /edgebase/shell. So again, depending on the memory, it will take some time, and it is going to start, it is going to take us to the Edgebase shell. So I am not actually fast forwarding so that it will be clear to you how, what kind of things it shows you to start the shell. So yeah, you can check, to start Edgebase shell, this is what it is showing you. Yeah, so right now I am on Edgebase shell. So it is Edgebase main, and the time it will show you. So here I can type HBase queries. This is your Hive, which is started in our case, and this is your HBase shell. So right now you are ready with Hadoop, HBase and Hive. So once we are ready, now you can proceed with all those problem statements which we have seen earlier. So this is your HBase terminal. So yeah, now we can proceed with the first problem, that is creating, dropping and altering database tables. So we are going to do these things with the help of HBase. So we will have to go to the HBase shell first, and then we will have to create database. We will see how to create database using HBase, how to create table, how to drop it. So Hive we will use later on. So let's start with HBase first. So the command to create the table in case of HBase is create, and in single quote, the table name comma column family names. So as I told you, HBase is a column oriented database. It uses column families. So the syntax is create in single quote table name comma in single quote whatever is there after that, those are the names of column families. So in our case, F info and F schedule. So flight 300 is the table name, and F info and F schedule are the column families. And list is the command to see which are the tables which are already created. So you can see flight 300 table already created. It is created after firing that command. Right. Now what we will do next is we will insert the data in flight 300 table. So to insert the data, this is the command: put, then the table name in which you want to insert the data, and that one is nothing but the row ID. That is for first row we are inserting the data. F information is nothing but flight information. So F info is the column family, colon source is the column name, and in our case the value of the source is Pune. So for the first row in flight 300 table, the source is Pune. And similarly, what we will do is in F info, that is flight information column family only, destination is the column name, dest, that is destination, and destination's value is Mumbai. So for first row only we are putting it, so it is also okay. Now the next is for the next column family, that is FSCH, that is flight schedule. So in this case we will put three different columns, that is arrival time, departure time and delay. So AT is nothing but arrival time, and the value of the arrival time we will put it here in single quote only. So there should not be a mistake in syntax while putting the values. If you make a mistake in the syntax, it is not going to run. So for example, the arrival time is 10:25 a.m. So it is also inserted. Similarly, we will put departure time for the flight for which the source is Pune and destination is Mumbai. So FSCH DT is nothing but the departure time. So let's say the departure time is 12:25 p.m. and press enter. It should insert the departure time also. Yeah. And the next one is for FSCH, that is flight schedule column family only, we will put delay. So we will assume that this delay is in minutes. So for the first flight, let us say the delay is of 10 minutes. So I have put 10 here. So yeah, it is also inserted in the table, flight 300. Now what we will do, same data we will insert for second row. So we will try to insert three to four more records. So for the second record in the flight 300 table, for F info column family, the value of the source we will put here in single quote. For example, the source is Delhi, right? So that is also inserted. After putting the source in F info column family, now we will put the value for dest, that is destination. So put the value here in single quote. For example, the destination is Jaipur. So for the same row ID, that is second, we will put or we will insert the values for next column family, that is F schedule. So let us say we will put arrival time here. So for the second flight, put the value of the arrival time in single quote. For example, the arrival time is 9 a.m. So we will put it as 9 a.m. For the second flight, the arrival time is 9 a.m. And similarly, for the same flight, we will put departure time also. So let us say in this case the departure time is this one, 9:30, or you can say, yeah, 9:30 a.m. So I could have skipped all these statements, but it should give a clear idea to you. That's why I am writing it one by one. So it might take some time, but we will do it like that only, so that there should not be any confusion. Then the next column is delay. So we are assuming that the values of the delays are in minutes, so I will put the delay as 5 minutes. So for second flight, the delay is of 5 minutes. Now we will do all those things for the third flight also. So what I will do is I will change the row ID from 2 to 3. So for third flight, we are putting the data now. So again, F info, that is flight information column family. Then we will put the source here, then comma, and in single quote we will put the value of the source. So for example, the source is Delhi, the source is Kolkata. So yeah, for third flight the source is Kolkata. And now we will put destination for third flight. The destination is Mumbai. And the next one is flight scheduling, that is arrival time and departure time. So for FSCH column family, we will put the value for AT, that is arrival time, and DT, that is departure time. So first of all, put arrival time first. So for the third flight, let's assume the arrival time and put it into single quote. For example, the arrival time is 11:30 a.m. And similarly, we can put departure time for the same flight, that is third one. So let's assume it's 11:50 a.m. So it should be DT, not AT, because AT we have already put. Yeah. And the next one is for the same column family, we need to put delay. Delay we are assuming within minutes. So for example, for the third flight, we'll put the delay value as 15 minutes. So it is also inserted. Now the last record we will put for the fourth flight. So I will change the ID, row ID as 4 from 3. So F information, again put source and destination. So put the source first. And let's say in this case the source is Mumbai. So value of the source in the fourth flight is Mumbai. Similarly, put the value for the destination. So DEST, and let's say for the fourth flight the destination is Pune. That should be in single quote. You should not make any mistake in the syntax, right? And the next one is we are going to put the values for FSCH column family, that is flight schedule column family. So we will put the arrival time first, that is AT, yeah, and we will put the value of arrival time in single quote. So let's say arrival time is 8:30 a.m. and then press enter. Yeah, it is inserted. And next one is for the same column family, departure time, and the value of the departure time we will put in here. So let me change. So let's say it is 8:50 a.m. and the last column is delay in FSCH column family. So delay is in minutes, so let's put the value of the delay here. For example, the delay is of 8 minutes. So press enter and you will see. So all those data is inserted. Now if I want to see the data which is inserted, what I can do is I can type a command called as scan, and in single quote name of the table. So in your case, flat 300. So this is what you can see. So this is the data for all those four flights which we have inserted into HBase table, that is flight 300 table. So you can see source, value of the source, right? And then you can see arrival time, delay, departure time for first, second and third and fourth flights. So there are four flights in our case for which we have inserted the data. Now next we will see how to alter the table or add one or more column families. Okay, so for altering, the command is alter and then the table name in single quote. So in our case the table name is flight 300 and then comma, and what we want to add name of that column family. For example, I want to add a column family called as revenue. So write it like this, revenue in single quote. So this is the command to alter your table for adding one or more column family. So it is showing you one out of one regions updated. That means it is successful. The alter command is successfully run. Now it will be, you will be able to see that revenue column family added once you insert the data into revenue. Now what we will do is, so we will use this put command and we will insert the data for the fourth flight in revenue column family. So let me write it like this, revenue colon, for example the column name in revenue is RS, that is rupees, and the value of that is, let's say it is 40,000. So put flight 300 for fourth one. So this is how you can run this command. Now if I check with scan for flight 300 table, I should be able to see revenue column family added into the table. So scan flight 300, see here you can check the column family is revenue, column name is rupees, and 40,000 is the value for rupees column which is in revenue column family. Now let's say I want to alter the table once again and I want to delete the column family revenue which I have added just now. So the command again is alter the table name, then alter in single quote flight 300 comma name of the column family which I want to delete, so it's revenue. So name equal to greater than sign in single quote revenue comma the method which I want to use. So I want to delete column family, that's why the method I will use is delete. So write down it like this, method equal to greater than sign in single quote name of the method, that is delete. So what it is going to do is, it is going to delete the column family called as revenue which we added. So just write it down like this and press enter, and we can check whether it is deleted or not. So just type scan command once again, you will not be able to see the revenue column family right now. So scan flight 300, if I type it like this and press enter, see it is there, but if I type right now scan, if I scan it, you will not be able to see any revenue column family. That means alter command is successfully run and we have deleted the column family. Now what we will do is, we will understand how to drop a table in HBase. So let's say first of all we'll create a table. So create a table with the name table 1 and column family name as CF. So let's say table 1, yeah, it is created. If I want to check whether it is created or not, I can type okay, list. Okay, so it is created. So if I want to drop it, I will write it down like this, drop and table name. But see, it is saying table must first be disabled. So always remember, in HBase whenever you want to drop a table, first of all you should disable it. Now to disable, this is the command, disable, and then in single quote the name of the table which you want to disable. So in our case it is table 1. So write it on like this and press enter. Now it is going to disable it, and now you can fire, after disabling it, now you can fire the drop table command once again. So drop space table 1, now it is going to drop it, right? So this is how you can drop a table in HBase. So if I type list, I am not going to see any table named as table 1. That means the drop command has successfully run in your case. So next what we will do is, we will fire some queries. For example, I want to know which are the records for first row. So get table name comma 1. So it is going to show me details about first record only. So see here, you can check, in our case the source was Pune, destination was Mumbai for the first record I am talking about, that is for the first flight. So it is like a where your query or filtering the records. Now next what I want to check is, I want to check for sources only for the first flight. So my command is going to change it like this: 1 comma column equal to f info, and I want to check only source. So I will write it in like this. So see here, you can check the sources, value of the source is Pune. So it is, this is how you can filter the records in Edgebase. And the command is get. So this is that's what we have seen. Now what we will see is how to read data for multiple columns in Edgebase table. So get flight 300 comma 1. So from first column, that is from source, and from second column, that is from destination. This is how you can write down the command for that. This command is going to show you source and destination for first flight only. See here, you can check the source is Pune and destination is Mumbai. So this is how you can write down the filtering queries. Now if I want to see all the sources, the values of all the sources only, so my command is going to be like this: scan table name comma the columns equal to greater than sign f info, and I want to see the sources only, so I will write down source f info colon source. So it is going to show me the values of all the sources for all the flights. That's 1 2 3 4, these are the row IDs, and the values are for source column only. See here, you can check Pune, Delhi, Mumbai, these are the sources in our case. Right, this is according to what we added earlier. So this is how you can work with Edgebase for creating, dropping database tables. Now next one is, we will see this one: creating an external Hive table to connect to the Edgebase for customer information table. And then we will see how to load the data table with data, insert new values and fields in the table. And later on we will talk about this join with Hive. So whatever the operations we will be doing right now, we will use Hive for that, because we want to create an external table. What is external table? That we will talk later on once we create it. So let's start with creating the table. The command is this one: create table and table name. So I want to create the table with this name: employee, that is EMP data 300, and the columns are name, that is name, ename and ecell. So this is the command. So create table EMP data 300 with these two columns, and then row format delimited fields terminated by some delimiter. So in our case, let's say the delimiter is comma, and stored as text file, and location of the table. So let's say the location of table is /home/Saurav. So this is the location on my machine. Here you can check /home/Saurav/employee data 300. So this is the command to create the table. So it is saying okay. So this is what, this is called as managed table which we have created. So this is the example how to create a managed table. Now I will insert some data. So before inserting the data, I will use some file. So currently I am at this location. I will show you the file which we are going to load in employee data 300 table. So you can check, there is a file called as empdb300.txt. This is the file which we are going to load into that Hive table. So let's check what are the contents of that file. So cat employeeDB300.txt. So see, name and salary. So you can check Sachin 5000 and then Yuvraj. So the values of the salaries are given. Now to load the data into the table, this is the command: load data local in path. And now here I will have to put the path of the file from which I want to load the data into the table EMP data 300. So /home/Saurav/EMP data 300.txt. This is my source file from which I want to from which I am going to load the data into the table. Into table and then table name. The table name is emp data 300 and then semicolon and you can press enter. Now it should load the data into emp data 300 table. If I want to check, you can fire SQL query and you will see. I have already created this table emp hive 300 with column family cf in HBase. What we are actually going to do is we are going to create external table in Hive, which is going to connect to the HBase table. So that's why I have created emp hive table, emp hive 300. Okay, now we will create external table in Hive referring to the HBase table emp hive 300. So to create the external table, the command is create external table. Create external, the table name is hive underscore table underscore emp 300 and then column names are id, name and salary, that is esal. So the column names and data types, we can write it down like this. Stored by, now what is this stored by? Stored by is the location where it is going to store the data. So in our case it is org.apache.hadoop. It's actually a namespace and it is going to use HBase storage handler. So what is storage handler? A specific storage handler may only implement some of the capabilities. For example, a given storage handler may allow read-only access or impose some other restrictions, right? So we are going to use that storage handler and we are going to use Faraday properties. So what is that storage handler actually is? Storage handlers are a combination of input format, output format and Faraday properties. Faraday properties is nothing but serialization and deserialization. And SERD is actually a short form for serialization, deserialization. I use a specific Faraday interface for input output. The interface handles both serialization and deserialization and also interpreting the results of serialization as individual fields for processing. A Faraday property allows Hive to read data from a table and write it back out to HDFS in any custom format. Anyone can write their own Faraday for their own data format. So the storage handler which we have used in this query, as I told you, storage handlers are combination of input format, output format and Faraday. And Faraday we have already talked about. Specific, it can be a combination of specific code also that Hive uses to treat an external entity as a standard Hive table. This allows the user to issue the queries seamlessly, whether the table represents a text file stored in Hadoop or column family stored in NoSQL database such as Apache HBase or Apache Kendra or Amazon DynamoDB. So here you can check it is saying me OK. And one more thing, the table properties, that is TBL properties, it is also there. So TBL property is a clause which allows you to tag the table definition with your own metadata key value pair. Some predicted table properties also exist, such as last modified user and last modified time, which are automatically added and managed by Hive. Now what next we are doing here is we are creating a table empdb new with these columns emp number and ename and esal. Why we are creating a table like this? Because it's a managed table and we cannot directly insert the data into external table. So what we will do is we will create a managed table first. We will get the data into that table. We will load the data into managed table and then from that managed table the data will be inserted into the external table. Now there are two types of tables in Hive. One is managed and another one is external table in Hive. So managed table, the difference is when you drop a table, if it is managed table, Hive deletes both data and metadata, but if it is external table, Hive only deletes metadata. So you can see we have created a managed table with the name empdb new 300. Now what I will do is I will insert the data into that managed table first. Now what data I will insert? I will insert the data from the file which is in this location. So let me show you which is that file. So see, empdb new 300.txt is the file from which we are going to insert data into the managed table which we created just now. So let me show you the contents of that file. So cat and then name of the file. See, ID, name and salary. So 1 Yogesh and 4000, for example. This is the first record. So this is what we are going to load into the managed table which we created just now. That is empdb new 300. So the command will be load command we are going to use. So load data local in path. Now the path of the file which we have just now seen, that is empdb new 300.txt. So it is /home/sourav/name of the file, that is empdb new 300.txt, in which we have some 8 to 9 records, right? So .txt, this is the path of the file which we are going to load into the managed table. So always remember there are two types of tables in Hive. One is called as managed and another one is called as external. And we already talked about the difference between the two. So this is the command for loading the data into that table. So it has loaded successfully. Now you can check whether the data is loaded or not. So this is the command to check. Select star from that table name. So in our case the table name is empdb new 300. So select star from empdb new 300. It should show you the data which we have just now seen in that file. So data should be there. Yeah, so see, 1 Yogesh 4000, 2 Sachin 5000. So the same data which you are able to see in the managed table. Now what we will do is we will insert the data into external table from this managed table. So the command will be insert into name of the external table. So in our case the name of the external table is hive_table_emp300. So insert into this table, select star from name of the managed table. So select star from empdb new 300. Now it should insert the data from the managed table to the external table. Once again I will repeat why we have created the external table, because it is not possible to directly load the data into the external table, external Hive table. That's why what we have done is we have first of all created the managed table empdb new 300. We loaded the data from a file into this managed table, and from this managed table we loaded the data into or inserted the data into external table. So you should be very much clear with these things and the difference between the external table and the managed table. So it is actually inserting the data into external table from the managed table right now. So at the back end there can be a MapReduce technique which is running for putting the data into the external table by using managed table. So see, here you can check it is mapping and reducing. So initially the both of the values for both are 0, that is map 0% and reduce 0%. But later on we will see mapping will be done first and then it will start with the reduction, because everything will be stored on HDFS, right? And HDFS uses a technique that is called as MapReduce for processing. That's why it is showing you like this, mapping and reduction. So it has started with this. Now see, you can check map is 100% and reduction is also 100%, and data is successfully loaded into the external table. Now what I can do is I can check in the external table directly by firing this SQL query or HiveQL query. So select star from name of the external table, and name of the external table is hive_table_emp300. So it should show me the same data which we have seen in the internal table, or it is called as managed table. So it is saying okay, and I should be able to see the data. So it might take some time. So select star from name of the external table. Yeah, now here you can check 1 Yogesh 4000, 10 Gautam, 1500. Now you can check the same data. Same data is here in external table also. So we have successfully created the external table and inserted the data into that. Right. Now the next one is what we will do is we will write down some queries for filtering the records. For example, I want to see only those people whose salary is greater than 3000. So where clause we will use here like this. So select start from name of the external table where, for example, ESAL is greater than 3000. So this is the query I am applying on external table. So see here you can check these are the people who are having the salary more than 3000. So Yogesh, Sachin, Rahul and so on. So this is how you can create external table and fire the queries. Now go to the HBase and fire this query. Scan EMP Hive 300. So you should be able to see the same data which we have seen in external table. So see Yogesh, Sachin, Gautam, same data, because now we have created an external table referring to the HBase table EMP Hive 300. That's why you are able to see the data. See, now if I insert more records in that external table by using an external table or manage table, you will be able to see the same change in HBase and vice versa. Right? So we have successfully integrated HBase, Hive and Hadoop, and you are able to see if we make a changes in either HBase or Hive, it will be reflected in both of them. Right? So what next we will do is we will create external table. Now we will follow the same procedure whatever we had done for employee table. Now we will create external table for flight information table. If you remember, we have at the start we have created a table called as flight 300 which showed us the information about the flight in HBase. Now what we will do is we will create an external table in Hive first. So this is the command: create external table HBase underscore flight underscore new 300 and flight number, flight source, flight destination. So the corresponding table we have already created in HBase. According to that only we are creating this external table in Hive with same number of column numbers. So there should not be any mistake in number of columns for the tables which you want to create in HBase referring to Hive and vice versa. So I am creating an external table in Hive which is referring to the HBase table flight 300 in HBase. So you should not make any mistake in the syntax. So I am trying to write down the same number of columns. So this is the column FSCH, that is flight schedule underscore delay, and data type I have mentioned, and then we will write down the location where it will be stored. So stored by in single quote, the namespace we will have to write down. We have already talked about all these things. So org.apache.hadoop.hive.hbase.storageHandler. So this is nothing but what we can say is a namespace or the location where we are going to store all the data out to HDFS. So we also talked about what is storage handler. So storage handler is nothing but the combination of input format, output format and SERDE, that is serialization and deserialization. So after this, that storage handler with SERDE properties is nothing but serialization and deserialization. It's a short for that serializer or deserializer. Hive uses SERDE interface for input output, right? So inside the SERDE properties you can write down HBase.columns.mapping. Actually it is for mapping the tables from HBase to Hive and vice versa. So HBase.columns.mapping. And so remember, always we should write down the first mapping of the column, the mapping of the first column, that is key, like this colon key, and then F info is the column family, source is the column, F info is the column family, destination is the column, and similarly FSCH is the column family, that is flight schedule, and here the column name is AT, that is arrival time, and similarly for DT, that is arrival time, and then last one is In FSC, it is called schedule column family. There is a column called as delay. So DT is the arrival time, departure time. And the last one is after this, in flight schedule column family only, there is a column called as delay. Yeah, so once we are done with this, we need to mention the table properties, that is TBL properties. So earlier also we have seen what are these TBL properties. So just write down it like this, TBL properties. So a TBL properties, it's a clause that allows you to tag the table definition with your own metadata key value pair. And we already talked that some predicted table properties also exist, such as list modified or last modified users and last modified time, which are automatically added and managed by Hive. So okay, I think there is some mistake. I will have to check. I think there is a spelling mistake. Let me check. So we will run all those lines once again. So this is the first line, create. I will have to go create. Let me check if we have made any mistake in this. So it seems there is no mistake. Create external table, all the spellings are right, all the syntaxes are right. So there is no problem in this. HBase underscore slider. So it seems okay. There might be some mistake, might be spelling mistake. It might happen because the query is somewhat longer. So it seems there is no mistake in this first line. So let me press enter here. Now the next line is stored by, that we will check. So it is org.apache.hadoop.hive.hbase.hbase200 is also right. There is nothing to change, it's absolutely right. So let me press enter once again. Now with Serde properties, then we will check Serde. Okay, I have made a mistake in spelling. See, you can check it here. It is columns. So the spelling is wrong. C-O-L-U-M-N-S. It should be corrected. Yeah. So that was a mistake. And now last one is table properties. It is also right. Press enter. Now it should say okay. Yeah. So we have successfully created the external table referring to the flight 300 table in HBase. So if I type show tables, it should show me the name of the table which you created just now. So it is hive underscore HBase underscore flight underscore new 300. So this is the external table which refers to the HBase table flight 300 in HBase. Now if I type select star from that table name, that is HBase underscore flight underscore new 300, it should display the records from the HBase flight 300 table which we created initially, that is source, destination, arrival time, departure time and delay. See, I should be able to see. Yeah, see here you can check. If you remember, we created this table in HBase and now we are able to access that table through Hive. So this is what is called as integration of HBase and Hive and Hadoop. So that was our aim. Now next we will move to HBase, and if I type the same scan flight 300, if I type this command, I will be able to see the same data. So this data which we are able to see in Hive is similar to this data which we are able to see in HBase. So that means they are successfully configured, HBase, Hive and Hadoop. So if you add anything in HBase, it will be reflected into Hive table also. So the next one, we will move to this one, find the average departure delay. So we will run the query in Hive and try to find out the average departure delay. So the function is a group function that is called as AVG we are going to use. So select AVG of name of the Hive table column we need to mention here. So the name of the Hive column in this case is FSCH underscore delay. So select AVG of FSCH underscore delay from the name of external table HBase underscore flight underscore new 300. So I should be able to see average departure delay. So it is going to use MapReduce technique at the back end So if I press enter, it is going to initiate that MapReduce process, and I should be able to see the average departure delay. So once again we will see mapping will be 0% and then reduce will be 0%, and then mapping will be increased, and then that is it. Then mapping will reach to 100% and then reduction will also reach to 100%, and finally we will be able to see the average departure delay. So that's what happening right now. It has initiated the MapReduce process and it is trying to find out average departure delay. So it might take some time in your case. It depends on the memory which we have provided. So in my case it's a virtual machine. So let's wait and check whether it will show or not. So yeah, map is 0% and reduce is also 0%. So after some time mapping should be 100 and then reduction should start, and then reduction should be completed. That is 100%. So let's see whether it will show us the result or not. I should get some value as a result because it's average delay. Yeah, so mapping is done. You can check here, mapping is 100% and now reduction should start and that should be done 100%. So it is showing you the cumulative CPU, the time it is taking. So see, mapping is also 100% done, and this is the value. So 9.5 is the average departure delay for our flight, for the flights, right? So delay, first delay was 10 minutes for first flight, for second flight it was 5 minutes, for third it was 15, and for fourth it was 8. So if you take the average of all these, you will get 9.5. that's what we have done by using HiveQL. That is Hive query language. Now the last part, okay, before the last part, okay, this one was remaining index. So we will see how to create index on that flight information table by using HiveQL. So to create the index, the HiveQL query is also similar to SQL query. So this is the query to create the index on Hive table. So create index and then index name. For example, the name of the index we will put as HBase flight new underscore index 300. So create index name. This is the syntax. Enter on name of the table. On table, name of the table. So I want to create index on HBase underscore flight underscore new 300. And for which column, that I will have to mention into parentheses. So I want to create it for delay column, that is FSCH underscore delay. Press enter, and as I want to mention as org.apache.hadoop.hive.ql.index.compact. So I want to create an index of the type compact. That's what I am mentioning here. So it's creating an index in the namespace org.apache.hadoop.hive.ql and compact index handler. So the name of the type of the index which we are creating here is compact index, and then press enter, and then we need to mention some properties like rebuild. So with deferred rebuild, this is the property we are mentioning for the index which we are creating. So there should not be any spelling mistake, there should not be any mistake in your syntax. If it is all okay, press enter, you should be able to create an index. Yeah, in my case it is okay. Now if I want to see the details of that index, I can type show index, and on show index on name of the table. So in our case the name of the table is HBase underscore flight underscore new 300, so it should show all the details. So see, this is the name of the index. This is the name of the table on which index is created, name of the column on which index is created, and name of the database which we have used, right? So this database we already created at the start. And now we will move to the last part, that is how to join tables by using Hive. So to understand how to join the tables using Hive, what we will do is we will create sample tables, we will load the data in those sample tables, and then we will join. So let's create a table first in Hive. So create table, table name. For example, the table name is EMP info 300. So create table EMP info 300 with columns as EMP, you know, that is employee number, EMP grade, that is employee grade, and row format, delimited fields, terminated by. So just assume that delimiter, the separator or the delimiter in our case is comma. That's how we will put it like this. Fields terminated by comma, stored as text file. So it should create a managed table in this case. So yeah, it is showing okay. That means it is created. So I will show you the file which I am using to insert the data. So this is the file which I am using to insert the data into that table, that is emp info 300.txt. So let's see the data. What is the data in that case? So cat it, cat name of the file. So this is the data, employee number and grade. So what we have is that file and the table created. So now we will load the data into that managed table using load command in Hive. So load data local in path, the path of the file from which you want to load the data into the managed Hive table. So slash home slash Saurav slash emp info 300.txt into table and then table name. So in our case, the name of the table which we created is emp info 300, and then put a semicolon and enter. It should load the data into the table from the text file. So it has successfully loaded the data into the table. And if you want to check, we can fire the command select star from that table name, that is emp info 300, put a semicolon, enter. You will see the same data here from that file, right? So now we have the data in our table emp info, and we already created a table that is emp db new 300. So let's see what kind of data is there in that emp db new 300 table. So select star from that table name and press enter. You will see this is data. So we are going to join this table with this one based on the employee numbers. So if employee number is match, it is going to show the result. So now let's write down the query for join. So select e number eno comma ename comma empno and emp grade. So these are the columns for which I want to see the information from emp db new 300, and I want to join this table to emp info 300. So join emp info 300 join. So this is a join we are writing, emp info 300 on. I want to write down the condition. So eno equal to empno on eno, this is the name of the column in the first table, and empno name of the column second, name of the column in the second table. So press enter. Now again it is going to run MapReduce at the back end, and we should be able to see the employee number, employee name, employee number and employee grade as a result of this query, of this join query. So again you will see mapping and reduction being done, and once it is completed you will be able to see the result here. So if employee number is matched in both the tables, it is going to show the result for that particular row. So again it will take the time according to memory available on your machine. So for my virtual machine I have given 5 GB of RAM. I have allocated 5 GB of RAM. So it is not going to take that much of time, and it is going to display us the result of the join query. So it has started with mapping and reduction, but till now the mapping is 0%, reduction is also 0%. So let's wait and see what kind of data you will see, what kind of result you will see here. So writing join queries, this is one of the examples. So yeah, mapping is 100% and reduction is also done. So see, this is the result of the join query which I got. So 1 Yogesh 1 and grade is A, 2 Sachin 2, grade is B. So how we got the data? We got the data by matching the first columns with the help of join condition. So see, for Sachin the grade is B, because you can check it here, grade B, the employee number, for employee number 1 grade is A. So employee number of Yogesh is 1, that's why Yogesh has got grade A, and for Sachin employee number is 2, that's why Sachin has got grade as B. You can check it here, and similarly for Rahul and other users also. So this is how you can write down the query. Now if I want to exit from the Hive, I can type exit. How to stop Edgebase? Just type exit, and then we will have to run one more command, that is called as --start-edgebase.sh. This is the command to stop Edgebase. So you can see it is stopping Edgebase. It will take some time to stop the Edgebase. So don't forget to exit from Hive and to stop Hive and Edgebase and Hadoop. So we are done with all these things. Sorry. And once you are done, you should stop Hive, Edgebase and Hadoop. So I have successfully exit from Hive, and now I am trying to stop Edgebase. Remember, while starting Edgebase also we have used two commands, and while stopping it again two commands. So it has successfully stopped Edgebase. Now you can exit from this terminal, or if you type JPS, you can check there are only the processes which are used for Hadoop. Those processes only it is going to show you. So exit. Now I should stop Hadoop also. So for stopping Hadoop, the command is stop-all.sh and press enter. So it is stopping all those nodes which we are able to see, that is name node, data node, node manager, resource manager and secondary name node. So once you are done with all the operations on Edgebase, Hive and Hadoop, you should stop it. So it is stopping data node, it is stopping name node. And it will stop secondary name node, node manager and resource managers also. Yeah, so you can check it here. So this is how you can work with Edgebase, Hive and Hadoop, and you can integrate all these three things, and you can use Edgebase and Hive on top of HDFS. Once it is done, and if I check with JPS, it should not show me all those nodes now. So if I type JPS, it should not show me name node, data node and all other nodes. So we have successfully stopped Hadoop. So finally, we have talked about all these things. So thank you very much. Thank you for watching. Thanks a lot.